Hey, why don't we get started? A couple minutes behind already. L'attention. Danke. Alrighty. And again, I'm Carl. I'll be covering today's class. Actually, Jeff is still trying to get out of Buffalo. So obviously with the weather, who knows when that will actually happen on that. And what we're going to be talking about today is going to be actually directly relevant to your upcoming project. It is concerning, if you will, pages and how the paging process works. So it's going to be something that, in a large extent, you're going to have to understand and implement as part of assignment 3.2. So it's a fun task, but kind of pay attention to some of the mechanics because it's relevant not just for the test, but in this case, directly to one of your coding projects on this. I assume by dint of you people sitting here, either you're taking a break, which is a smart idea, or if you are winding down just in terms of coding here, you have a couple more days left on that. Yeah, you're getting crunched for time. Do speak to the staff in terms of prioritizing how to best use your remaining time on this. I can also say no matter what happens on this, do remember that the time that you spend on assignment 2 is not wasted because you're still going to need this for assignment 3 because these projects are cumulative, and in order to pass the test for assignment 3, essentially you do need a working assignment 2. So no matter what happens, this is definitely, if you will, needed time, and it'll help you later on as you go through the rest of the course on that. So as far as that goes, remember Friday, we are not going to have official class on that. It's just going to be kind of extended office hours. I'll leave extending that, and we hope to send out more information in the next couple days on that. Aside from that, make use of obviously office hours tomorrow too, and then presumably next week you will be dipping your toes into the white sand beaches of Tahiti or Fiji, so enjoy that week off. And then the week back, obviously, is going to be midterms again. Do make sure that at least at some point you start looking over the material. Don't leave it for the week back. And again, for those of you who have been playing hooky in video land, I said this last time, again, if you have let Jeff's lectures pile up and you at this point have N lectures to watch, again, trying to go through a whole bunch of lectures and have the stuff actually stick is going to be somewhat problematic. So that could actually be perhaps something for you to do while you are dipping your toes into the white sand beaches in Tahiti. Watch some of Jeff's lectures so that you'll be all set when it comes time back for midterm week. I digress from my hectoring. Let's talk about the rest of the classes today here. Okay, what actually is a page? And remember, we've got these two concepts of memory. We've got physical memory and we've got virtual memory, and I didn't pause for questions. Questions I can ask before we actually go into today's sermon. And by the way, I guess everyone gets a plenary indulgence for being here. Okay, if you are here, this is so much the better. I'm sorry? There you go. But I mean, just general questions about class progress, projects. All right. Diving right in. Okay, how can we locate a page state? And this kind of dives, if you will, delves in with, well, page faults and translating between physical pages and virtual pages. Let's take a look at this. By page state, again, you've heard the term state ever since 115 on this. Remember, roughly speaking, it's the metadata about something. In other words, the page is simply by definition a block of 4K of memory that the user or the kernel uses on this. But when we're talking about page state is, well, what about it? In other words, as far as the user is concerned, is this page, well, in real memory? Is it on disk? Does it exist at all? Has it been written to recently? Where in physical memory is it? In other words, it's information that the system as a whole needs to know about memory. So it's memory about memory on this. And that's going to be important because that's essentially the gravamen of your assignment 3, is keeping track of memory. You're writing a memory manager. Again, it's a cool project on this. So a couple things here in terms of TLB. Remember the general, if you will, approach of what's going on here. Remember I talked about this last Friday. We always begin with the user refers to a virtual address. All right. Well, what do we do with the virtual address? Because remember, a virtual address really doesn't exist. All right, the virtual address goes to the MMU, the memory management unit, essentially this TLB thingamabob here. And this TLB thingamabob does some sort of a translation. Specifically, it checks to see, do I have an entry for this particular virtual address on this? And if I do, well, I can now kind of determine what physical address if it is. If I don't have an entry for that, I'm going to have to actually, if you will, ask for help from the kernel, because remember, it's the kernel that keeps track of, if you will, all the information about virtual to page virtual to physical translation on that. So again, user refers to a virtual address. The virtual address goes to the MMU in hardware. The hardware checks to see whether or not there's an entry. If so, it does the translation on the fly and completely silently to the software. If not, it has to poke the OS for help. Hey, I need you to tell me a little bit more information on this. So from the standpoint of the operating system, we have to keep this TLB up to date. Remember back to 341, you talked a little bit about data caches. In other words, the idea is we've got, if you will, a small amount of memory that in the case of a data cache is fast, and ideally we want to keep it populated with stuff that we're using all the time. Well, it's going to be an analog for the TLB, because the TLB, it's not a cache of data. What it is, it's a cache of address translation information on this. So it's our job as a kernel, as a virtual memory manager, to try to keep this TLB updated with really, really relevant, useful information about this, if you will, translation. Because just like with, remember if you talked in 341 about, if you will, schemes for, let's say, data cache eviction, because we want to try to keep cache misses as infrequent as possible, same thing here in terms of the TLB. What we're going to try to do, and what you're going to be implementing as part of assignment 3, is, if you will, making sure that we keep the TLB up to date with stuff that is going to minimize the number of page faults, because that's going to increase the performance of your system. The user is going to be happy, or in your case, a student, you're going to be able to pass the test a lot easier on this. So we want to keep it with, if you will, up-to-date information here, and this is actually what we need here. Store information about each virtual page here. Okay, what that means is, again, storing metadata about the virtual page. Remember I was mentioning earlier, where is the page? Okay, a virtual page is, again, kind of only an abstraction, but where is the underlying physical page? Is it in memory? If so, where is it in memory? Is it on disk? If so, where is it on disk? Does it even exist at all? Has it been written to? So that's what we mean by, again, storing information, if you will, metadata about the page. We'll look at some sample types of entries that you might put into your metadata in a few minutes. The second part about this is an issue of performance on this. As you can imagine, in an operating system, page faults happen all the time. Right? And as a result, you need to service them very quickly on this. Ideally, we don't want to have to service them at all. That's why we have this TLB and hardware on this. And again, this is why we want to try to minimize the number of page faults. But you know what? Sometimes they are inevitable. And when we do have a page fault that actually goes to the kernel, we need to be able to locate this information quickly. So performance is going to be a problem on this. I know my old code that I had written for OS 161, I remember I had a bit of a problem with this a year ago, because we came out with new and updated tests for last year's class. And all of a sudden, my code, which heretofore had been passing just Jim Dandy on the previous set of tests, started flunking because the new tests, if you will, were more demanding in terms of time constraints on that. So I had to add some optimizations in here. So again, kind of with page state, there's two things. What is the page state that we need to keep track of? But number two, we need to be able to get at that page state very quickly and efficiently on this. So kind of recap, we talked a little bit about how we get at, if you will, from virtual to physical. We talk a little bit about, if you will, what is this page state and why we need to get at it quickly. Questions, comments so far? Going once, going twice. Boom, sold. Right, selling lots of vases here. All right, PTEs, page table entries. These are essentially the thingamabobs that, if you will, store information about a single virtual page here. So again, the page table entry is the struct that is going to store your metadata. So you've got a 4K block of, if you will, data that is the data, and then we've got however many bytes are in this page table entry that stored, if you will, metadata on this. And again, essentially, as you can imagine, this is per virtual page on this. So again, each virtual page has a page table entry. By the way, to digress, I know Jeff talked about on Monday about core map and stuff like that, but in terms of core map, you also need to keep track of per physical page frame metadata also. That's part of assignment 3.1. I'm going to be talking about that in under an hour if you're going over to recitation and Franzek. So again, if you will, to digress, you need to keep track of metadata for each physical page that's in the core map, aka physical page frame map, and you need to keep track of metadata for each virtual page, and that's going to be a page table entry in your drumroll page table on this. So sorry for the alphabet soup of terms. This makes sense so far on this. Yes, no, heads bobbing. Okay. Alrighty. Okay, page table entries here. Okay. Now, what Jeff is suggesting here, I will say, don't try to, if you will, take this as you have to follow this model exactly right now. Remember Jeff's post about KISS, keep it simple theory. Okay, sit down with your partners right now, and in terms of what you're designing to what to put into these page table entries, come up with what you think you might eventually need to put into it, but start simple. What do I need to do to get started on that? Same thing is true with a core map. Like, what do I need at this point in time? And then think ahead so you're not painting yourself into a corner. But again, I will tell you right now, if especially there's been stuff like if you look at old blogs and whatnot, they suggest you need to do this, 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 and this, because they're throwing the kitchen sink of all these possibilities. Or if you Google this stuff online, okay, you'll see, let's say, Wikipedia articles about, let's say, what Linux does in terms, or Linux, I should say, or Linux, or however it is you say, what Linux does in terms of storing metadata. It's going to be far more information than what you need initially to get past the hurdle of 3.2. So what is the information that we actually kind of need to store in a page table entry? Well, at the very least, what do we need? Remember, if we have a page fault, that means we went to the TLB. The TLB could not locate an entry translating a virtual address to a physical address. So it says operating system help. All right. So what's the first thing we need? We know the virtual address because that is the fault address. Okay, that's the address on which we had the fault, the page fault, the exception, if you will. But what we don't know is this thingamabob, the physical page number. So that's, at the very least, what we need is the information. Given a particular virtual address, I need to be able to grab what the corresponding physical address is. And then, by the way, people, what do I do with that? So, like, let's say that I fault on virtual address 1000, and it tells me that it is corresponding to physical address 234567. Okay? Well, now the operating system knows that. Okay? But what does the operating system do with that information then? Ideas? How did we get to be in the operating system in the first place? Coming from where? I'm sorry? User land, but then what between user land and what happened in user land that caused us to land in the operating system? A trap, yeah, a page fault, right. Okay, and why did we have a trap? What piece of hardware caused the trap? We user referred to a virtual address, and the virtual address goes to what? Well, we hope it goes to actual memory, but how do we remember back to last Friday? MMU, the TLB, exactly, right. So the MMU is looking for a, if you will, virtual to physical mapping, and it didn't find that. That's the thing that causes the page fault. The MMU signals the page fault in hardware. Makes sense? So this was the problem, but we want solutions. We don't want problems. So how do we repair the problem? We have the virtual address. Let's say we have looked at the page table entry, and we now have, let's say, the physical page. What can I do with that? I can put that information in the MMU. Exactly, right. Okay, because remember what the MMU is. It's simply a cache of translation information here. So in other words, what's going on here is we have a page table entry. We had a fault. Okay, from the fault, we retrieve the corresponding physical address, and we have to take that physical address and update the cache in the TLB. As you can imagine, that is a privileged set of opcodes that will do that. Users are not allowed to do that. This is getting into the whole policeman and enforcement mechanism. The kernel is allowed to do that because someone has to do it. Right? And then ideally we return to the user land. The user is happy as a clam, doesn't even know that there was a page fault. It's totally seamless to user code. At least we hope that that's the case. Now there's some other metadata on here that Jeff's going to be talking about, especially in terms of optimizations later on here, but things like, for example, permission. One of the things about virtual memory that's cool is you can do stuff like, I talked about this last Friday too, you can mark a particular page as being, let's say, you can't execute it to prevent data execution attacks. You can mark it as being, let's say, read-only. So that the user doesn't accidentally munge on executable code. Stuff like that. So you can actually, you want to keep track of what the permissions are for a particular, if you will, virtual page here. Other stuff like valid. And valid, we can actually even take that a step further. There's kind of two things. It does the data exist anywhere at all, but if it does, where is it? Is it in memory? Is it somewhere on disk? What have you on that question?
How do you pass this information up?
Yes, that's exactly right. If you look in, it's like, what was it, arc, MIPS, VM, TLB.h, okay, there's documentation for that. That's actually some of the bits that you have to set in the hardware registers. In other words, not just the virtual to physical translation, but you also very definitely, okay, have to tell the hardware, okay, let's say reads are allowed, or writes are allowed, or executes are allowed, etc. on this. Okay, along with other things like you don't have to support this in OS 161 unless you want to on this, and that is you can have multiple processes with valid entries in the TLB at one time on that. Right? Because again, the idea is in a production system we want to try to keep eviction as infrequent as possible and page faults as infrequent as possible. Answer your question on that? Other questions? Okay, so again, this is more about metadata, if you will. Permissions, valid, reference. The nice thing about a reference, that's going to be cool when it comes to eviction on this. Remember, we probably talked about, I know I've mentioned it, I'm sure Jeff has probably mentioned it several times, in terms of the technique of using the past to predict the future on this. So one of the things that we want to keep track of is what pages get used a lot. So this referenced bit, and it may not even, you might want to get fancy and have more than one bit, how often does a particular page get referenced? Because that's going to allow you to make smart decisions in terms of which ones we want to evict and all that stuff later on. So, but anyway, again, this is not gospel. You definitely need the physical page address, but you're going to be adding in some other stuff. I can definitely tell you this, definitely there's some other stuff like in terms of synchronization that you're going to have in here too. But again, my point is, in initially designing stuff with your partner, don't paint yourself into a corner, but start simple. So you're going to have a physical address, but then going beyond that, you know, don't worry about coming up with everything right away. All right, page state on this. So let's see what we have here. Okay, well, this kind of walks through what we were talking about earlier. Okay, we are in user land, and I want to store to a particular address. Go to the MMU, and again, now at this step, if the MMU has the information, it doesn't go to the kernel. And that's kind of ideally what we want. Think about this as terms of a matter of policy. This is a good exam question. How could we design our system to try to keep this kernel help stuff to be as infrequent as possible? So again, policy, what we want to make sure is that we do know what virtual address we're about 10,000 maps to. But if we don't, we have to go to the kernel here, exception, kernel. Okay, now at this point, what Jeff's trying to get handle is, take a look at this. Well, let's see, where did I put that page table entry? Give me a minute. It's around here somewhere. Probably looks like the underside of my desk in the lab. All right, point being here is, if the kernel is having a hard time of it locating this information, it means what is going to happen to the user experience? Okay. Well, it's not even necessarily, it could crash, yes.
No, I mean but the user experience.
What? Yeah, the user is going to feel very ticked off at this. In other words, if we have a poorly designed MMU, even if it works logically, if in terms of performance it's slow, it's going to impact the performance of the entire system here. So this is going to be, up until now with assignment 2, it's essentially been a case of functionality and logic. One of the tough parts about assignment three, and well, actually, it's probably good that you're getting to it in this class, but because I know a lot of classes don't talk about it here at UB, but in order to get past the hurdles, especially of a 3.3, there's going to be time performance constraints on this. In other words, how can you get this information in a reasonable amount of time? So you're going to have to not just get the answer, but get the answer quickly and implement a bunch of optimizations. And let's actually talk about some how we can do this here. So what we need to do here is speed. Okay, it's basically a hot path. Given a page fault, we need to, if you will, unpage fault ASAP on this. All right, but the other thing too is, remember, we've got this, if you will, time-space trade-off here. We want quickness, but we also know that we have limited resources on this. So we have to balance that against not chewing down too much of the memory, because then user experience is going to be degraded in that way. So let's see how we can kind of balance this. Question so far? Comment so far? Complaint so far? Page tables. All right, the data structure we need to quickly map. Basically, this is the translation again from virtual to, if you will, a page table entry. Essentially, virtual to physical plus virtual to some other metadata is a page table, and it holds these things that you can imagine called page table entries on this. So again, this is the guts of assignment 3.2. 3.1 is going the other way. You know, that's your physical map, that's your core map, that's information about physical, and also indirectly physical to virtual, but kind of leave that aside for now. But if you will, page table is information about virtual and how it maps to physical on this. Interesting. Each process has a separate page table. Now let's, again, go back to core map for just a minute. Core map is your, if you will, mapping of physical memory on this. That's the RAM chips when you pop the cover of your computer on this. And the RAM chips are, if you will, shared by all processes, which tells you who uses the core map. Which process? Kernel. How about if I'm process foo or if I'm process Firefox? Do I need to use that? Well, maybe not directly, but indirectly? Yeah, right? How about process bar? If process bar is, who knows, Opera browser. Right? My point is what? Who uses the core map? Which process?
All of them.
Bingo. All of them. Okay. So it's something that has to be shared, which of course introduces some mutex issues on here. But now wait a minute here. Here we're talking about this mapping of virtual pages, and now we're getting off saying here that each process has its own separate page table. Why do we need that? Why can't we have, if you will, a mapping of virtual to physical that is system-wide here? Glad you asked. Virtual addresses are private to each process and translated differently for each on this. Remember back, I forget which one of Jeff's lectures I was covering. I had mentioned that one of the nice things about virtual memory is it allows the programmer in user space to make some simplifying assumptions. For example, executable code always begins at address 400,000 or whatever it happens to be. Okay, and remember we said then that's not quite true, because if you think about it, okay, let's say process foo has its executable beginning on address 400,000. Process bar has its executable beginning at address 400,000. Wait a minute, how can that be the case? You can't have two things in the same place at the same time. What is this? It's like the Pauli exclusion principle of virtual memory. So what we have here is, how can we actually implement this? It's through, if you will, the concept of virtual memory here. So each process has an entry that essentially says, my executable, which begins at 400,000, maps to what? A different physical location in memory. And that's how I'm able to pull that stunt off. Make sense? And this is why we need information on a per process basis here. Because, again, what one virtual address appears to be in one process may map to something completely different from something in another. How about fork? Think about this. Have you ever wondered how, you know, it's probably, you just call this AS copy thingamabob and it duplicates the address space. Well, it doesn't duplicate the address space. We've been slightly sloppy about that. Because if it were an exact 100% clone of the child to the parent, they would be munging on each other's memory. What's being copied, if you will, duplicated, is the virtual addresses. But underlying that, all right, they get two different address spaces, and in two different address spaces, the same virtual addresses are pointing to different areas in physical memory on this. So it's not quite duplication in a very strict sense of the term, if this makes sense. Okay, question before we go on to actually implementation. Okay. And one other thing, I don't know if Jeff probably is going to talk about this after break too, in terms of virtual versus physical on this. In general, each virtual address has to map to a unique physical address for a given address space. Okay. Now, you can have the same virtual address space in different processes or different address spaces map to, if you will, the same physical address space, though. Okay. That's actually how you can support stuff like, if you will, copy on write for fork on this. So, in other words, you can have, let's say, two different virtual addresses in two different processes map to the same bunch of executable code. Because, let's say, someone is called fork, and we're just going to be lazy and say we're just not even going to bother, if you will, copying physical memory. We're just going to kind of redirect, if you will, the virtual addresses in different address spaces to point to the same physical address space. But by and large, what we're going to have is, if you will, each virtual, let's say, the same virtual address space in different address spaces point to different physical addresses. What you can have is, if you will, different virtual addresses in the same address space point to the same physical address. So it kind of sounds weird, but it is possible, and it is allowed by the TLB on this. In other words, we can have the same, if you will, block of physical memory appear at different virtual locations on this, but we can't go in the other direction. Okay. Otherwise, if you try to do this, you try to put an entry in the TLB with, let's say, for the same address space 1,000 maps to 1 million, and then address space 1,000 maps to 2 million, it's going to burp up at you and say, well, which one do you want me to do? Flip a coin when the user says 1,000? So again, it's a mapping. Okay. Given one virtual address, it can point to one and only one physical address within a particular address space. Make sense? Okay. The last part is to talk about implementation. And this is getting in a little bit into the mechanics. And in terms of what your implementation is for assignment 3.2, this is, again, do a little bit of thinking on this. Sit down with your partner, sit down with some of the staff. There's pros and cons. There's no one right answer. I certainly have my political orientation on this. Other people have their political orientation on what is the right answer, and everyone else is a heretic on this. So let's take a look at this here. One way of doing this is a flat page table. Let's take a look at this. Let's say we've got, here is our virtual address space in user space here. And you remember, okay, what we're trying to do is map virtual addresses. So if this is a 32-bit system, by definition, we have to map all potential 32-bit addresses, 2 to the 32 addresses. In other words, 4 gigabytes by definition. And by map, I mean we have to be able to provide some sort of an answer with what's there, because the user could potentially refer to any address between 000 through FFFFFF. You get the idea on that. And so I need to have some data structure that is going to allow me as a kernel to kind of spit back what the status of a particular page is anywhere in that 32-bit address space. Mini digression, when it comes to core map on this, how much are we trying to map? If it's on a 32-bit system, we may or may not have 32 bits, that is 4 gigabytes of physical memory. We may, but it may actually be a subset of that. So in the case of a core map, it's kind of a slightly different kettle of fish. Again, talk about that in probably about half an hour or so. But for now, let's talk about flat page tables and see what's going on. We have to map all, if you will, 4 gigabytes of address space. Everyone see why? Okay, So option number one is we have 4 gigabytes of address space. So I, in effect, have to, let's just declare, if you will, a flat page table that has essentially an entry for every single potential page. Probably just declare it as one gigundous uber array on this. And as a matter of fact, we can even be specific. How big is this array going to be in terms of number of sizes here? 4 gigabyte system, 32 bits, okay? If we have a 4K page size, do a little bit of division, so it's 4 gigabytes divided by 4K pages, that's going to mean we're going to have exactly 1 binary million entries in our page table on this. And this will work like a charm here. So in other words, let's just say I have a bunch of these page table entries, and let's say that part of the code here maps to somewhere in this page table, and there's the page table entry. Part of the heap maps to someplace corresponding in the page table. There it is. Presumably these page table entries are declared on the heap, okay? But this page table itself, think of this as analogous. You know, you had the file table, and then that in effect pointed to, if you will, file handles. Same thing here. We've got a flat page table, probably like an array of pointers or something like that. And for each of these things, it's pointing to something of, let's say, an existing page table entry here. Simple to implement here. Now the issue is here, let's take a look at this here. Speed, it's very quick because for any given virtual address, I can immediately map over what is its entry in the page table. Right? Because again, all I need to do is essentially drop off the lowest 12 bits, okay, and I have still the top 20 bits. That's going to give me 2 to the 20th entries. I know exactly which, if you will, entry in the array to go to, and I can then speed over and take a look at my page table entry. So very quick. Compactness. This is the fly in the ointment on here. In effect, by definition, I have to map 4 gigabytes of memory, 1 million potential entries, so my flat page table must, by definition, support, if you will, 1 million entries. Now, interesting, if I have 4 gigabytes of RAM, it probably is not going to be that difficult having something like that. I can fit it into memory. It's going to be maybe a little bit wasteful, but I can make it do. But if I have, let's say, a smaller amount of memory, let's say 16 megabytes or 4 megabytes or something like that, you know, just going to configure your kernel on some of the tighter bit tests with 1 or 2 megabytes of memory. Good luck trying to fit an array with 1 million entries into 1 megabyte of memory. It's not even going to fit into memory. So, Houston, we have a problem. Well, option number 2, if it ain't an array, let's go for a list on this. So, I'm sorry? 2 slides ahead. All right. So for now, linked list here. Okay, or hash bucket. All right. Okay, so linked list here. So that's what we have here. Back to our virtual address space here. And here are page table entries here. And we need to link up again. We have to potentially support all 2 to the 32 entries here. So instead of having an array that has an entry for all, if you will, 1 million pages, okay, how are we going to do that? We're just going to kind of chain these buggers up together, and here we go. Let's say if we have a page fault in some area in code, we're going to check, is it this page table entry? No. Well, how about check the next one? Nope. Going to the next one. Next one. Nope. In other words, basically we're iterating our list, and finally you can see we hit our match on here. So we essentially have to iterate over our list. Eventually we will get our answer on this. And again, this is the old time-space trade-off. Speed, definitely not a go for a production system. You do not want to waltz, if you will, like molasses through a list in a production system. That's not going to work. For a West 161, it is good enough. So this definitely is an option that you can use for implementing your page tables. If you are fond of lists, again, this is one of these holy wars on here. Compacting nodes into my list. Well, obviously when the program launches to support, if you will, let's say some initial information, but then as the program loads, okay, I'm going to have a bunch of page faults to load in those executables and insert node, 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 node. And then when the program starts running and it starts using let's say, the stack and heap segments, I'm going to have to do more insertions on this. So I'm definitely going to have to support insertions throughout the runtime of the kernel. Maybe that's the ultimate answer to your question. Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Other questions? Thank you for bringing that up. That's actually a gotcha that came up last year. I know University of Toronto used to always force their students to do that. Well, now it's true here too. And that's actually the way real operating systems work, to be frank. So in other words, you simply mark areas as valid, and then you're going to have to actually support, if you will, on-demand allocation of this. And by allocation, remember, that involves two steps. Number one is creating the metadata, and number two, allocating the underlying physical memory on that. And again, that's kind of part of your design document on this. Do sit down again with your partner, think this through. I know I and my partner had many, many midnight whiteboard sessions by the vending machines in Davis that had just opened at the time. So do that, make use of the office staff, and take it from there. Aside from that, thanks for coming, people. Enjoy spring break next week, midterm the week after that. We're going to be talking about CoreMap in about a few minutes or so. Hasta la vista.
Okay, sweet.